And leave your neighbor sleeping or your roommate sleeping, then you just walk out as if you're some silent agent somewhere. We are agents of Jesus, and we are loud, and we can talk for Jesus, and we can inform them, guys, it's time for Sunday. It's better tell them, and they don't make it than just keeping quiet. Praise God. We are ambassador. Tell your neighbor, I'm an ambassador of Jesus. Hey. And so we have the Transform Camp that is coming in September. It's the days are drawing closer than before. Hey. And so that offer for half the price is about to end because the number is increasing very fast. So you had better pay your 20K registration fee, those of you who have not yet, and make sure you are registered and enjoy that for half pay offer before we get to now go to 80K per person. And this coming Saturday, we'll be having baptism on the 9th of July. So please, if you want to be baptized by immersion, please come and see me or any of our leaders, and we'll include you in the list. Classes are ongoing, but if you're going to register, we'll have to organize several classes for you to catch up with the rest of the guys. Otherwise, we appreciate each one of you so much for your commitment to UFC, United Faith Chapel. You are all amazing people. And so, before I get to invite Pastor Ken, who'll be taking us on the next session, I'd love to recognize amazing group of people. If you're here for the first time, we just want to celebrate you. With your hand just raised up. I will not ask you to come here. We just want to clap. Is there any visitor today? Is anyone praying with us for the first time today? Just put up your hand. Oh, Kema! Thank you so much for coming. And there are some of us who have not raised our hands, but we appreciate you. We recognize you. Thank you so much. Please, at the end of the service, don't be in a rush. We just have to have a few minutes of your time to just engage together as we get to know each other better. So, ladies and gentlemen, right about now, allow me ask you all to put our hands together as we'll come out. Dear Pastor Kennedy Kirui will be taking us on from there.
Morning, church.
Morning.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Yeah, there are many reasons for us to celebrate, and praise the Lord this morning. Amen. Thank you so much for coming into the house of the Lord. I pray that you had a good week, and that God has continued to be faithful in your life and your family and your studies or work. And so I thank God that you're here. So one is, allow me to again, in a special way, appreciate Albert and Pastor Matt and the team for what they did yesterday. That was amazing. I really wanted to be there, but my wife was preaching somewhere, and I just had to be home and be the mama and the papa, which is good. But I want to appreciate you very much. Thank you for using that opportunity and the gifts and the talents that God has given you as a means to bring people to celebrate, but also as an opportunity to share the gospel. We pray that those 15 will be helped to know God more, and that so we have a new responsibility from there again to help them to walk that journey with them. But I want to appreciate you. Let's just give a big hand clap to Jesus for that. Matt, thank you so much. I know you put a lot into that, securing location and all those things. Thank you very much, and God bless you. I cannot miss to appreciate my young man here, Joseph Thomas. Doesn't speak a lot, but he does a lot. He's a man of actions. He does a lot, even in this church. You know, he enables many things to happen here. And he does it with a lot of joy. You'll never hear him complain at any time about anything. But also his work with Christ is just very evident. And so I was not surprised that this was going to come. Yeah. But I think I have the joy also to inform you that their wedding is coming up.
Soon.
So once we celebrate for Susan in September, then in December, I think on 10th, if I'm not wrong, we will have a wedding. I know these things, you know. I'm aware. I want to appreciate you, Joseph Thomas. So, and I hope that is just a lesson for the rest of us who are here. to just walk in the light and trust God through the rest of the process of your life. And we have people here who are willing to help you walk that journey and to help you, you know, take the next step by faith. Yeah. So there are many people who have been, you know yourself, let me not get there. Yeah, but I think it's about time. It's about time. Thank you. We're happy when God does wonderful things like that in his church. Amen?
Amen.
Yeah. So, Thomas, I congratulate you, and I'm so proud of you. Yeah. Many things I want to say, but allow me to just focus on what we have this morning. We thank God for the opportunity to dedicate the children that we were able to do last week. Those are some of the great moments for us as leaders and pastors in this church to see happen. And I know there's one child we are here to. He was not feeling well, or she was not feeling well last week. So we still hope we can be able to do that. But we are glad, and we celebrate as a church every good thing that God does, from dedicating children to celebrating engagements and all those things, to thanking God for lives that are coming to Jesus every week. This morning we have an opportunity to meet at the Lord's table, and just a great thing for us to come together and just to be reminded again how much God loves us. That God loves us so much that he actually invites us to sit with him at his table. And you know, we live in a society where, you know, people are categorized according to, you know, their level of education, the level of their finances, you know, whatever. But thank God that, you know, when we come to Jesus, you know, the ground is level at the foot of the cross. That all of us have an equal opportunity before Jesus. And we can come before him and really, you know, receive the grace and the mercy that God has offered to us. You know, to be reminded again of the love of God. The Bible says that God demonstrates his love for us, that while yet we are still sinners, he sent his son to die for us. That we could be reconciled back to him, and that God has been in the business of bringing us back, you know, into the original design that God had intended, that we will continue to live in his presence for the rest of our life. So through the first Adam, sin comes into the world, but through Jesus, the second Adam, you know, all of us are restored back into the family of God. And we have the special blessing. You know, the Bible says to all those who received him and believed him, he gave them the special privilege to be called the children of God. And so even as we meet at the Lord's table, we come not as strangers and visitors, but we come as children of God. We come as children of God, loved and highly favored of God. And so I pray that even as we meet today, you will just be reminded, you know, Eucharist means thanksgiving. It's a moment of thanksgiving. Thanking God for all that he has done for us. And you know, the psalmist says, bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits. You know, as human beings, we have the tendency to forget. And I think that's why Jesus reminds us that we should do this as often as we can. You know, to be reminded of how much we are loved by God. To be reminded of how much, you know, we are favored by God, and how God continues to lavish us with his extravagant grace every day in our lives. And that we have not been left to figure out life by ourselves, but that God offers us in his own presence through his Holy Spirit to help us even as we live our life. But that it's all by grace. We have been given the grace that we need for everything. You know, the Bible says the grace of God has appeared to all men. You know, we the grace of God that teaches us not just how to live our life, but that enables us to live a victorious life. The grace of God that comes to save. The grace of God that comes to sustain, to sanctify, and transform us, and to help us to be the kind of people that God wants for us to be. So even as we meet at the Lord's table today and as we share communion, I pray that for you it's just a moment to reflect how much you are loved by God, that you are included in the family of God, and that you are not a stranger, but that you are a child of God, that God loves you. You know, it doesn't matter where you've been and how, you know, things have been. I pray that today, even if you've been walking away from God, I pray that today, like the prodigal son, you can come and know that there is a father that is running towards you with his arms wide open, ready to receive you and embrace you with his love, because he loves you and he cares for you, and his desire is that you will come back home. And every time you come back home, you know, there's always a party, celebration. And so I pray that this morning, as we come with joy, because we are coming to meet with our Father, one that loves us like no one else. Yeah. But also, as we come, we also come knowing that God is empowering us and equipping us with everything that we need to live a life that is worthy the calling that we have received in Christ Jesus. So sometimes we experience defeat in one area or the other in our lives, but as we come here today, we are reminded that he is Emmanuel, God with us, and that we can trust Him to help us through every part of our journey. He can help us navigate through every season and every phase of our life. So I don't know what you've been finding challenging, and how, you know, what areas, you know, maybe the enemy has been trying to bring you down. I pray that today you'll just appropriate the grace and the goodness of God in your life, and just really, there's life. Jesus says, you know, He gives us life and life in abundance, and victorious life that we receive in Christ Jesus. Yeah. But also, you know, as Paul says, it's a time also for us to examine ourselves, how we've been walking our lives, and how we've been living this life, and how we live our life in a manner that is pleasing before God. So it's just several things together that happens as we come and meet together at the Lord's table. At QFC, if the leaders can come in, who can come up, who are helping us with serving the communion, please come. You know, yeah, please come. Yeah. So I think what I was just wanting to say is, you know, as we meet, you know, to celebrate communion, one of the things that Jesus reminds us is that we proclaim His death until He comes again. And one of the things that we'll be studying even today, as we think about, you know, the Bible, is the prophetic accuracy of the Word of God. And one of the things that the Bible tells us is that Jesus will come back again. And Jesus says, you know, as you do this, you proclaim His death until He comes again. And so this is just a reminder for us again that, you know, this is not the end of the story for us. There's much more. Yeah? There's a perfect supper that we are going to have, you know, before the presence of God, all of us together, the whole Church of Christ together. You know, there's a bigger party and a bigger celebration coming. And this is just a sign, you know, of the big things that are yet to come when the Son of God comes back in His fullness. So I pray that God will help you, that it will keep your hope alive, and that you will keep waiting and keep hoping, and that your hope will be revived and renewed as we wait for the second coming of Jesus Christ. So may God bless you, and I'll just ask us to just take a moment just to pray and to thank God, you know, and just thank God for His love for you. Thank God for His favor upon your life. Thank God for the gift of salvation that He has given you. You know, there is nothing that we can pay, no amount, you know, the Bible says even no sacrifice, no animal sacrifice could not even be sufficient to atone for our sins. And Jesus becomes once and for all, you know, sacrifice for our sin. You know, He becomes both the offer and the offerer. You know, He comes, you know, as the priest, but also as a sacrifice for us. And it becomes a once and for all sacrifice for our sins. And just take some time to thank Jesus, you know, just for His love for you and for all that God has done for us through Jesus Christ. That allows us even the blessing and the gift to come together as a family this morning. And that we can call each other brother and sister in Christ because of what God has done to us through Jesus Christ. But also to remember, you know, even as we do this morning, is that Jesus says, as the Father has sent me, I also sent you. You know, that as we come as a family, you know, that we are sent out by Jesus again. You know, we are broken and poured out for the reconciliation of the whole world. And we have the ministry of reconciliation, reconciling all things to Himself. And just pray that God will help you to really play your role well in going out there, like the team that went out yesterday, and inviting all people to come to Jesus Christ. Heavenly Father, we thank You so much for this wonderful opportunity that we have, Lord, to fulfill and to obey Your word. Jesus, You told us after that evening that You shared with Your disciples, Lord, You instituted the Holy Communion, and Lord, You told us to do this as often as we can in remembrance of You. And You say, for as long as we do this, we proclaim Your death until You return. And Father, we just want to thank You so much this morning, Lord, for how much You have loved us. Your word tells us that You demonstrated Your love for us in that while yet we were still sinners, You sent Your Son to die for us. And so, Lord, we are grateful. Now, Lord, that because of that, Lord, we have acceptance, we have restoration, we have been adopted, we have been justified and sanctified. Lord, there are some, just all the benefits, Lord, that You've given us through Your Son, Jesus Christ. And Lord, we are grateful. And this morning, even as we just share in this bread and this cup, Lord, I pray that, Lord, may they be to us a means of Your grace to remind us again, Lord, how much we are loved and favored of You. And Lord, just be reminded, Lord, that You have not left us alone, but Lord, You are here with us. And you've given us everything that we need for life and godliness. So Lord, I pray that you'll just bless us. And Lord, that this session will be very significant in our life this morning, because Lord, you are here with us. So Lord, would you just sanctify these elements of communion, and Lord, would you use it to accomplish even your purpose in our lives this morning. For this we ask with thanksgiving in Jesus' name. Amen. So our ushers are going to pass around and they'll pass the elements of communion. Just feel free to pick the bread and pick the cup and wait until all of us have received. Then we will share together. Father, once again, we just want to say thank you so much for your love for us. David says, if the Lord had not been on our side, where would we be? And Lord, just even singing the words of this song this morning and just being reminded again, Lord, even just to think, where would we have been if not for Jesus? And Lord, we are grateful this morning. Thank you that once we were lost, but now we are found. That once, Lord, we were just out there, Lord, even without belonging, but now we belong in the family of God because of all that you have done for us through your Son, Jesus Christ. Thank you, Father, because of all that you have done for us. Thank you for what you're doing, and thank you even for what you will continue to do in our lives. The Bible says, the night on which he was betrayed, you know, he took bread. And when he had given thanks, the Bible says he broke it and said, take it. And said, this is my body, which is broken for you. And Jesus reminds us and says, do this in remembrance of me, the body of Christ that was broken for you. So let's share this together. In the same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, this cup is a new covenant in my blood. And Jesus says, "This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me, the blood of Christ that was shed for you." I just want to give you a moment to just reflect and just thank God. We cannot thank God enough, because sometimes even thank you doesn't seem sufficient for all that Christ has done for us. The Apostle Paul, he says, for this reason, I bow my knees to Christ the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. He says, from whom the whole family in heaven and earth is named, that he will grant you, according to the riches of his glory, to be strengthened with might through his Spirit in the inner man, that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the width and length and the depth and the height, to know the love of Christ which passes knowledge, that you may be filled with all fullness of God. And now to him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that's at work, that works in us, he says, to him be glory in the church by Christ Jesus to all generations, forever and ever. Amen. Amen. May God bless you, and may God just remind you how much he loves you again, even not just this week, but for the rest of your life. Amen. I just want to invite us to stand up together as we sing together, and as the ushers will be collecting the cups. Even as we
This is a call from the mountain of God. Tamira, Tamira, Thanksgiving and Jordan. Tamira.
Steven and your team, you do a good job. We appreciate you. Today, several of our parents out there, you know, today is a visiting day for many parents. And so I think several of our parents, I know Mary and Judith, and I want to imagine even Farida and others are somewhere visiting with their children today. So we can just pray for them, even as they have a good time with their children in school. For the last 2 weeks, and today, now the third week, we are going through a series talking about the Holy Bible. and just looking at, you know, the Word of God and to understand that, because last week we said it's difficult to love something or someone that you don't understand. Understanding, you know, lays the foundation for us to know people so that, you know, or something, so that you can love and, you know, experience someone or something even more better. And so that's true even for the Word of God, is that if you don't understand the Word of God, it becomes difficult for us to love it and to commit to it, to live by it. And that's why, you know, we just want to take some few weeks to just remind ourselves again about the Word of God and the importance and the place of that in our lives. All the theology, or, you know, the study of God and the things of God that we have, you know, finds its foundation in the Word of God. And so it will be difficult for us to really even know anything about God that we have now, why not from the Bible? Everything that you know about God at least comes from this Word. You know, of course, unless it is about God from our traditional, you know, religions, but from a Christian standpoint, everything that we know about God has been made possible through the Word of God. And so it's important for us to go back to the Word of God and let the Word of God help us. So last week we talked about understanding the Word and, you know, the importance for you to find an easier translation of the Bible that is easy for you to understand. Make sure that you set aside some time for you to study the Word of God. You know, the importance of doing that in community with other people. You know, journaling and, you know, making notes based on the things that you're learning and how God is speaking to you every time, and the importance of that. And I want to appreciate you. You know, I'm informed that there was such a big number of you turned up for Bible study this last week, and I want to appreciate you. Can we just clap for ourselves and just celebrate? And we look forward to even having more, most of us, because as we said, you know, we as a church, we come and help each other. All of us, you know, we come and share from our experience and revelation that God has given us, and we have something to offer to each other. So that's very good, and I want to appreciate you. Today I want to look at the other side of it and just, you know, the Bible in 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 15, the Bible talks to us as children of God, and the Bible says, but in your heart it says, sanctify, you know, the Lord God in your hearts, and always be prepared to give an answer to anyone who asks you the reason for the hope that is in you. And the Bible says, do this with gentleness and respect. Always be prepared to give an answer to everyone that asks you the reason for the hope that you have. And the Bible says, do this with respect and gentleness. You know, I don't know, one of the greatest questions that I am sure someone will ask you, or maybe even you've asked yourself before, is what? How do you know that the Bible is reliable? How do you know that the Bible is trustworthy? If you go to someone and tell them, the Bible says, and they tell you, how do you know that the Bible is trustworthy? How do you know that the Bible is reliable? How will you answer that? How will you, you know, how do you yourself even today really know that this Word is trustworthy, is reliable, because it's the Word of God? I know you don't doubt that, but just to help us this morning to think through that and just to really answer that question for us. But you know, if someone were to ask you, you know, why do you accept the Bible as the absolute truth? Because we live in a world where, you know, people are saying there's no absolute truth. Truth is relative. So, but for you, as a child of God, you know, what's the basis for you to really claim that the Bible is the absolute truth, or, you know, and is the Word of God? You know, I don't know if for you as a person, you know, you have experienced the peace and blessing that comes from living its supernatural life-transforming message. You know, that you, as a person, you can testify of the life-transforming power of the Word of God, the peace and the joy that comes with, you know, from the Word of God, and even in the midst of the challenges that sometimes we have in life, you know, that God's Word has spoken to you, because the Word of God is living and active. It's not in the past tense. It's present continuous. You know, God continually speaks to us as His people. We live in a world where many people, including Christians, are questioning the integrity and the authenticity of the Word of God. Many people who have been well-meaning, some people who have even gone to Bible college, seeking to know God so that they can serve God more. And some of them have ended there and ended up losing it. And so the question is just for us as children of God, you know, what can we do so that, you know, we have a right foundation, you know, with the Word of God? If you're a true follower of Jesus, it's important for you to believe that the Bible is the Word of God. It's important that you believe that the Bible is the Word of God and that it can be trusted completely. The challenge we have in our time is that we have people who want to selectively choose which part of the Bible they works for them and what doesn't work for them. You know, and that's not good. You know, you're creating your own religion. That is not Christianity. That's not how God intended for it to be. You know, you have to accept the whole counsel of God and submit to the whole counsel of God. When we come to a place where you just want to submit what works for you and reject what doesn't work for you, you know, that's not what God requires of us. You are creating your own some form, you know, unique religion of some sort. But, you know, we must come to a place where, as followers of Jesus, we believe that we believe, and we believe that the Word of God is true, and that the Bible is indeed the Word of God. And the Word of God speaks to us at all times. It speaks to us at all times. As a pastor, you know, we meet people, you know, in different spaces and in different seasons of life. Sometimes when people are celebrating, like we're celebrating this morning, you know, someone's engagement. Or sometimes when people have gone through the most difficult, you know, situations of their life, the Bible speaks to us in the times of our celebration and even in our times of sorrow and pain. You know, the Word of God speaks to us. When people are faced with great challenges of heartaches and sorrow and testing and trials, you know, the only thing that provides real confidence and hope is the holy, inspired Word of God. Sometimes even the music that we listen to, you know, especially when relationships have gone so, some of us go revert to some music that, but you know, you know, but you realize it doesn't sink deep, it doesn't last long. You know, when the song is over, the pain is real. Yeah. But we have to believe in the Word of God. It's the only Word of, you know, there's no other anchor for our soul that compares to the Word of God. And so that's why I pray that you would come to a place where you would really believe that the Word of God, you know, that the Bible is the Word of God and is the absolute truth. You know, and whereas the Bible speaks to, of itself through many proofs that the Bible is reliable, there are other external, you know, extra-biblical sources that actually even continue to affirm to us that the Bible is true. And so we don't go to them to really believe that the Bible is true, but it just supports that actually the claims of the Bible are true, and we'll look at some of those this morning. You know, Jesus, the Bible says in Psalm 119, 160, says, all your words are true. Not some of your words. Psalm 119, verse 160 says, all your words are true. He says, your just laws will stand forever. You know, all the words of God are true. That's the testimony of the Word of God concerning itself. Is that every part of Scripture, because sometimes people have come and say, you know, maybe there are historical errors in this text, in this text, but the testimony of God's Word itself is that all your words are true and your just laws will stand forever. You know, Jesus said, your word is truth. You know, sanctify us with your truth. Your Word is truth. This is a testimony of Jesus himself. God himself testifies to us that his Word is true. And that's important for us. Jesus says, heaven and earth will disappear, but my words will remain forever. You know, many things, you know, this is testimony that Jesus speaks of himself. It's like many things, you know, there are two things that at least the Bible claims that will never disappear. It's the soul of human being and the Word of God. The eternal. He says all these other things will pass away, but the Word of God will remain forever. And we know that the soul of a human being, you know, it's eternal, only that it depends, you know, whether you'll spend your time in heaven or in hell. But at least that's what the Bible tells us. So, irrespective of what you think about the Word of God will always be there. And the Word of God is true, and nothing will change. People may change, circumstances may change around our lives, but the Word of God is the timely, timeless truth of of God that will never change. And the most important thing is that we can just place our trust in who God says and what God says about his Word. You know, in Hebrews chapter 6, verse 18, the Bible says God has given us both his promise and his hope. And it says these two things are unchangeable because it is impossible for God to lie. God cannot go against his Word. God is not a human being that he can lie. And so if God says that his Word is true, as a church, we have to stand on the authority of the Word of God, that the Word of God is truth and is absolute truth. And so that's something that we need to remind ourselves. And the Bible says, therefore, we who have fled to him for refuge can take new courage. For we can hold to his promise with confidence. we can hold to the promise with confidence because this is the word of God. And it comes from God himself, who the Bible says it is impossible for God to lie. So I pray that God will help you. You know, these and many other scriptures in the Bible, you know, help us to prove and to testify of the Bible, you know, the internal evidence of the Bible and the Bible speaking to itself about the truth of the word of God. Every single word of the Bible is completely accurate and trustworthy. And I pray that you believe that. But, you know, there are a few other evidences that I just want to look at and things that people have looked at through the ages that helps us to really know that the word of God is trustworthy and reliable. So that if someone asks, you know, so why do you believe that the word of God is truth? Why is it reliable? Why is it trustworthy? You know, that you can be able to respond to this. And this, no one's, you know, everyone's learning is dependent on the knowledge of other people. And so these are things that I've gathered from different sources, from different people who have written about this true history. The first proof or the first, you know, thing that can help us to talk about reliability on the trustworthiness of the Bible is what we call the prophetic accuracy of the word of God. Prophetic accuracy of the word of God. You know, the reliability of the Bible is seen in the amazing fulfillment, you know, of the Old Testament prophecy in the New Testament. You know, there are over 2,500 prophecies that have been written in the Bible. And 2,000 of those prophecies have come to pass exactly in the way that it was said, despite the time difference that was said. You know, the 500 that are remaining are what in the book of Revelation. And I hope you know that if the 2,000 have come to happen, I hope that it helps you if you are doubting about the second coming of Jesus and what the Bible says in Revelation. I hope it helps you to know that it will happen. You know, people have studied probability. You know, I'm not a mathematician and I try to avoid numbers when I can. But, you know, like in terms of probability and people who study probability and to say, you know, the chances that something which have happened can happen again. People who have studied the Bible and the prophets that have come to pass. You know, there's just high, you know, like I think it's one to I don't know what power. You know, that the Bible, that whatever the Bible says will come to pass will happen because based on what has already happened. And so the prophetic accuracy of the Bible, you know, it is one undeniable proof that the Bible can stand the test of time. Because everything that was said, despite the fact that we said last week and the other week, that the Bible was written over a period of 1,600 years, written by 40 different authors in three different continents and three different languages, but yet, these people never even had a chance to meet with each other. Never sat down to say, now let's write a book that you will write this chapter, I will write this book. They never. But yet, you know, whatever was said by Isaiah comes to happen. You know, 700 years prophesying, you know, prophesying about the birth of Jesus Christ. In between the coming of Jesus and the last prophecy was like 400 years, the silent, you know, period. But, you know, Even beyond that, the word of God still came to happen the way that God has always said. From Genesis, when God says, you know, the son of a woman, you know, the seed of a woman, you know, it comes. And it's come to fulfill in the book of Matthew, you know, in the Gospels, many years later, over 3,000 years later. So the word of God is prophetic accuracy of the word of God. You know, and you know, when you read the Bible, you realize that the Hebrews or the Jewish people, they were very categorical also about prophecy. If you read in Deuteronomy, you know, if someone claimed that they were speaking for God and they were not, they actually will be killed. If you read in Deuteronomy. But in Deuteronomy chapter 18, verse 21 to chapter 18, 21 to 22, the Bible says, you may wonder, how will we know whether the prophet is from the Lord or not? It says, if the prophet predicts something in the Lord's name and does not happen, and it does not happen, the Lord did not give the message. It says that prophet has spoken on his own and need not to be feared. So there is a proof from the Bible itself that, you know, the word of God is, you know, like the prophetic fulfillment of everything that was said helps us to know that the word of God is true. You know, the prophecy about the you know, virgin birth of Jesus, you know, was said in Isaiah chapter 7, you know, verse 14, you know, and it comes to be fulfilled in Luke chapter 1, verse 26, 700 or almost 800 years later. The ministry of Jesus in Galilee, you know, is prophesied in Isaiah chapter 9 and is fulfilled in Matthew chapter 4, verse 12. You know, the teacher, you know, Jesus teaching and using parables to teach, you know, is said in Psalm 78, verse 2, and is fulfilled in Matthew chapter 13. You know, that Jesus will be crucified with thieves. Even that precision, you know, Isaiah chapter 53, verse 12, and it comes to be fulfilled in Matthew chapter 27, verse 38. You know, and many other, including the ascension of Jesus. Even David, I don't know if he knew, but he talked about, he prophesied about the crucifixion of Jesus. At a time when even punishing through crucifixion had not been devised. You know, the Romans came up with this way of killing people. Yeah? And even by when David talked about it, it had never even been devised as a means of torturing and killing people, but he talks about it. So all these things help us to prove and to understand that the word of God is true. Everything that God says is true. And we need to believe that the word of God is true. So my question is just, imagine if today you heard that there was an author in town who has written a book about, has prophesied many things and they have come to happen, and is in town, you know, signing this book out somewhere. You know, what do you think will happen in Kampala? Huh? There'll be chaos, eh? Everyone will want to go to that person. You know, most people go to witch doctors and people call themselves prophets because most of us have there's that existential thing in us. We are so concerned about things that we do not know and we fear what we do not know. And people want to go to some of those people. You know, but, you know, God has, everything that God has told us will happen has actually happened. And everything that he has told us will happen, will happen. So, instead of running, you know, the word of God is here. Yeah, it's here. You need to just read the word of God. Go to the word of God and everything concerning your life from before to after is here. And you can trust the word of God. The other thing about the Bible that we talk about is what we call the historical accuracy. You know, for a long time, many claimed that the Bible is filled with historical errors. And they pointed out, you know, several biblical accounts, particularly the Old Testament, which, you know, where maybe sometimes archaeology had not actually discovered and proven that maybe it was true and it was there. So what happened over the years is that many scientists, you know, had tried to come up with different claims to say that maybe the Bible was inaccurate because they had not found maybe some archaeological discovery concerning something. Then they said maybe it's not trustworthy and reliable. For example, many people had doubted the kingship of King David. And many people thought that maybe it's just fiction. They talked about him because they had not found any evidence, for example, about that. But it's not long ago that someone, an archaeologist, actually found something that was written by the Assyrians in 9th BC, you know, that talks about, you know, the enemies of Assyria. And in the list of the enemies of Assyria, they had written there the house of Israel and the house of David. And so it has come to be proven. You know, so there, people look for some small things to say maybe it's not true. But thank God that God, in his own wisdom, you know, makes that possible. You know, think about the flood, for example. Some people used to think maybe the flood did not happen. But they go back to the history of the Babylonians. People who did not even believe in the God that we believe in. But in their history, they record about the flood. And they record about a period before the flood where people used to live for many years. You know, you read before then, people used to live for 900 years, right? And you know, so they recorded, there's recordings about that that actually helps us to prove historical accuracy of the Bible. You know, there are people used to think that maybe the story of the patriarchs, people like Abraham and Lot and the stories in Genesis, they said maybe this is just fiction. But not so long ago, you know, they found something called the Ebla archives, that tablets that dates back to 2300 BC that actually reveal and talk about the stories of the patriarchs, Abraham and other people, to prove that the Bible is actually true and its story is true. One of the things that people have doubted for a long time is the existence of the Hittites. You know the Hittites in the Bible. I say there was nothing like the Hittites in the Bible. But you know, not so long ago, you know, something that was considered a legend, they found the capital of the Hittite Empire, you know, somewhere in Turkey. So the Bible is historically accurate. You can go to the places that are said in the Bible and you'll find it. You can go to find a river called Tigris and Euphrates somewhere. You can find whatever the word is, the Bible says, as places and people, they actually lived and the places existed. So it was not just stories. You can go and find these places. And that's why the Bible is true. And you know, part of the other thing also is that historical accuracy of the Bible is that the eyewitness accounts, in the New Testament especially, you know, there are people who saw, there are people who wrote, even people who are not Christians, historians like Josephus, who actually wrote and had different stories about Jesus. And the people wrote about the experience of that. So there's what we call eyewitness account. But also, the accuracy and the precision with which the Bible was written and copied, you know, also helps us to understand that For example, the book of the Gospels, that four different people were writing about the same account, and all of them were writing differently, but the whole story connects together. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, they're all writing differently. It's not that they agreed and say, now you go and write. But yet their stories talk about the same places, same events, same miracles, same things because of, and that points to us the historical accuracy of the Word of God. But also think about archaeology. You know, science has come to help actually prove many things about the Bible. And people are continuing to discover more. They are continuing to discover more. Carbon dating, that helps us to realize how old this could be true, and then we realize that it connects with actually what the Bible says. So all these things come to help us to know that the Bible is true. But the last thing, the other thing we talk about is the unity of the Bible. And we've talked about this last week and the other week. You know that the Bible, you know, the miraculous fact that the Bible is that, you know, is that it has, it's thematically unified. It's one message, though it was written by 40 different people over 1,600 years in different places, but yet the message of the Bible is one. That unity of the Bible in itself is a proof that the word, the Bible is the word of God. That there could be one other author who influenced the authorship of all these other authors, and that that author is God himself. So we talk about the unity of the Bible. And so I pray that God will help you. The Bible presents a unified message, not a loose assortment of religious presentation. It's one message. The unity of the Bible is one of the clearest indications of the supernatural origin, you know, of the Word of God. The Quran was written by one man called Muhammad. The letters of Confucius was written by one man, Confucius. Buddha, the books of Buddha was written by one man. But this was, God used 40 different people over 1600 years, and the message of the word is one. Amen? It's one message. Why? It's because there's one other, and that is God himself. It's one other, and that's God himself. The Bible is unquestionably the book that was authored by God. And I pray that you believe that the word of God is true. The other thing is the scientific accuracy. Science, you know, the Bible says in Psalm 148, verse 5 and 6, it says, let every created thing give praise to the Lord, for he issued his command, and they came into being. You know, we know that creation did not just happen. It was not a big bang. It is something that was created by an intelligible being, God himself. You know, everything that we talk about, you know, we talk about the theological argument, you know, when you see a designer, there must be a designer. You know, there's many things that prove to us that God actually created the universe. You know, for a long time, there are people who used to think that the earth was flat, you know, until people like Galileo came and, you know, discovered that actually it was not flat. The earth was is round, you know, and you know, long before Isaiah, in Isaiah chapter 40, verse 22, what did he say? He said that God sits enthroned above the circle of the earth. When we talk about the circle of the earth, it talks about, you know, sphere, from which we get the word globe. So in other words, you know, before the scientists could believe that the world is actually not a flat, but it's a circle, it's a globe, it had already been seen, you know, the Bible had already talked about it. It's just that people didn't want to go to the Bible. You know, when we think about, you know, that the heart is held up, you know, long before, and maybe let me just shock you again, maybe I didn't say this last week. You know, the Bible, the way it's written, when you see Genesis, you know, Revelation, you know, Genesis, the way it happens, it doesn't mean that that's the chronological way that the Bible was written. The book of Job is actually one of the oldest books that we have in the Bible. And the book of Job was written so early. So early, maybe around 2,500 or 3,000 BC. And so sometimes, you know, that's something we may need to talk about at another time. But you know, Job, in Job chapter 26, verse 7, he says, it spreads out the northern skies over empty space. And he says, it suspends the earth over nothing. You know, some of our old religions, like the Greek mythology, the Greek used to think that the heart is held, you know, by, you know, they talk about something that was in the back of an elephant, you know, that was suspending and holding the earth together up there. You know, some people used to think, you know, maybe the Egyptians, who are very sophisticated in technology and, you know, innovations, but the Egyptians used to think that God was supporting the earth with five strong pillars. But, you know, long before, these guys could discover how the heart is, you know, God had already said it. And someone wants to ask yourself, you know, how did Job know? Because God told him. Because this is about God. You know, so even when you think about numbers, you know, think about the stars. You know, some early, you know, scientists and philosophers used to think that they could count the stars. And some guy, you know, called Aeropagus, I think, and told me, you know, that around 100 AD, one of them had counted and says there's 1,022 stars. And then Ptolemy came a few years later and he says, no, you missed. You missed four. They are not 122, they are actually 1,026. But of course, now we know. If you go to Google today, they will tell you that there are 200 billion trillion stars. 200 billion trillion. I don't know what those numbers look like. But if you go to the Bible in Jeremiah chapter 33, verse 22, he says that the sky, the stars of the sky cannot be counted. In other words, you know, it's innumerable. You cannot. So the word of God speaks to these things. Even what science, you know, science, so we think about scientific accuracy, you know, the word of God has that scientific accuracy and many things that I cannot go to because time will not allow. The other argument that we have or reason to believe in the word of God is the indestructibility of the Bible. That the Bible cannot be destroyed. Indestructibility of the Bible. There are many people over the ages who have tried to fight the Bible. You know, the Bible is the most despised, most derided, most denied, most disputed, most dissected, most debated, most outlawed, and most destroyed book in history. But yet it continues to remain the most sold book, the most translated book, the book that continues to be read more than any other book in the world, despite all that. And you know, the Bible truly has lasted longer than any other book. You can go to a library today, wherever you can go and find the oldest book, you'll find that there's no other book that's older than the Word of God. The Bible has survived, and I know many generations. And what's amazing about this record is that the Bible has survived, you know, in spite of tremendous persecution through the years. And this just to prove to us that the word of God is true. For over 2,000 years, you know, man's hatred for the Bible has been persistent, determined, relentless, and murderous. People have been killed for believing in the Bible and to try to make people not believe in the Bible. Every possible effort has been made to undermine faith in the inspiration and authority of the Bible. You know, innumerable enterprises have been undertaken to consign it to oblivion. Imperial edicts have been issued to the effect that every copy of the Bible should be destroyed, but the Bible has always survived that. There's an emperor in Rome called Diocletian. In 303 AD and thereabouts, he killed every person that believed in the Bible and he requested that every copy of the Bible would be brought and burned. And if you knew that someone had the Bible and you kept quiet, you would also be killed for that. And so many Bibles was destroyed in Rome than any other period of time. And he came and said, I have totally obliterated Christianity and there's no Bible anymore. But guess what? After Diocletian died, Constantine comes as the new emperor. And Constantine makes Christianity the state religion for Rome. Yeah? And Constantine, you know, he requests and says, if anyone has a copy of the Bible, bring and I'll reward you. And somehow they're able to find 50 copies of the Bible. And of course, they continue to do the translation. And the word of God continues to spread. You know? So the word of God is indestructible. You know, places like Russia and China, where they have tried to suppress, it, instead of it getting weaker, it gets stronger. Instead, even the people have said, you know, the blood of the martyrs has become the seed of the gospel. Where they think they want to kill it, it actually continues to multiply even more. There's a French philosopher called Voltaire who said, you know, in 100 years, the Bible will be no more and Christianity will be no more. Of course, even now, maybe some of us are hearing for the first time the name Voltaire because all we know is that his name disappeared. But, you know, Voltaire had a printing press. And this printing press became a printing press for the Bible. His house to today, this man who said the Bible will be dead in 100 years, his house is what holds what is called the Geneva Bible Society. From his house, people are translating and sending Bibles to many other places because the word of God is indestructible. Why? It's because the Bible says in 1 Peter chapter 4, chapter 24, 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 24 to 25, it says, the grass withers, the flowers fall, but the word of the Lord endures forever. Amen? The word of the Lord endures forever. But also think about the translations of the Bible that has been translated through many languages and many, many times. But the word of God has remained to be true and authentic. That can only be a miracle that God can only give to us. You know, we have this thing we call the broken telephone, eh? The game that we play. I tell you something in your ear and say, tell someone. By the time it gets the other side, normally, it's totally different from what he said. But the Bible has not been like that. It's been translated from one time to another, from years to years, but it has remained authentic and true. Amen? That is the word of God. That's the word of God. Lastly, is the evidence of transformed lives. Evidence of transformed lives. We can say about all these other things. But you know, in the book of, in John chapter 8, verse 31 to 32, Jesus says, if you hold my teaching, and you are really, you know, he says, you are really my disciples. He says, then you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. You know, there are hundreds and, you know, there are thousands and thousands of people who maybe even never trusted the word of God, and they read the word of God, and their life never remained the same. You know, most of us who are here and standing even before you today, you know, we are the way we are because of the transforming power of the word of God. The evidence of transformed lives, that people who have read this book, their lives have never remained the same. And that is the greatest evidence that we have. The Bible has life-changing power. You know, the Bible says, you know, the gospel, you know, is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us is the power of life. You know, that is the word of God to us. It's that it changes people. It's the power of God unto salvation for all men. And I pray that God will help you. That, you know, beyond everything, you know, the testimony of scriptures, you know, Matthew chapter 5, 18, Jesus says, for truly I tell you, until heaven and earth disappear, not smallest letter, not the least stroke of a pen will by any means disappear from the law until everything is accomplished. Why am I saying this? It's because this is a testimony of Jesus himself concerning his word. I don't know, if I am a follower of Jesus, and if I have acknowledged Jesus as my Lord and Savior, then that means that I will believe what Jesus says. And I'll believe what Jesus says about the word of God. And if Jesus says that this is the word of God, then I must submit myself to what Jesus says. And Jesus says that this is the word of God. You know, if you trust in Jesus as Lord, then you will trust what he says, that this is the word of God. And I'm happy this morning to point to you the words of Jesus. The words of Jesus that will change your life forever. The words of Jesus that when you read it, your life will never remain the same. And if you point someone to it and they trust God to just speak to them, their lives will never remain the same. So I pray that God will help you. That you will let God's word be the standard for your life. That you will not be swayed by the world's reasoning and even by your own feelings. That you can always search for the right way to think and act based on the word of God. And that the word of God will become the lenses. On Friday here, Friday Connect, we're talking about lenses. May the word of God be the lenses through which you interpret reality for your life and everything else about your life. Yeah, and so that's why it's so vital for us to understand the central message of the Bible. We can believe that the Bible is reliable, but until we know what it says, its trustworthiness cannot be helpful for any one of us. And that's why you need to read the word of God. My question as I finish is this. Will you attack God's word, or will you live by it? You know, one of my friends who was here and we studied together sometime, the other day he went to China and, you know, he just graduated recently with, you know, a terminal degree. And but, you know, it's easy that sometimes our education can puff us up. And so the other day I see he has come and he has posted a picture of the Bible and is critiquing about that. I'm like, you know, what's the point? What's the point? If you don't like the picture on the cover of this Bible, go buy a Bible which doesn't have a cover like that. Yeah, don't come and say that this picture, you know, it looks at Africans, I don't know like what. No, you go look for the other one. You know, the enemy will always try to find reasons to make you doubt and mistrust the word of God. And so the question for you today is, will you attack or will you live by the word of God? Will you deconstruct it or will you defend it? Will you look for places that just seem good for you and reject others, or will you defend the word of God? The question is, will you follow the world or will you follow the word of God? David says, I've hidden your word in my heart so that I cannot sin against you. And he says, your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path. And I pray that God will help you, that you will commit to the word of God. Amen. Yeah, Pastor Daniel, if you can come and conclude for us this morning. Yeah, thank you so much. God bless you. And
a round of applause. I appreciate Pastor Kid for sharing the word with us this morning. And a big one for God for using him this morning. A number of things have been shared. I don't know what you have noted down, what you've jotted down. We have been given every reason to believe in God's word. Every reason. So there's no doubt at all. And so we've got to be those ambassadors who share the same word of God out there. Because you know why we believe in the word. Praise God. Told us about a number of things. Prophetic accuracy, the historical accuracy, eyewitnesses, the unity of the Bible, the scientific accuracy. You know, the indestructibility of the Bible, serious English even in there. Evidence of transformed lives, including you. Praise God. So we have every reason. I'll just read this last statement. Last statement he mentioned here. He says, will you attack God's word or live by it? Praise God. Let's pray together. Even if I let me just give you a minute or two to pray through what we have been told this morning. And you ask him, Lord, help me to live by your word. Help me to defend your word. Help me to believe it by faith. For everything that pertains God, it is done so by faith. Maybe you had doubts somewhere. Or maybe the pressures of life pushed you against the wall so much that you felt maybe there is another way somewhere in God's word. This is a time that God, through his servant, has reminded us in the power of the Holy Spirit that the word is truth. Maybe there are promises that have not come to pass yet. We have been reminded that everything will come to pass. You tell him, Father, help me to rely on your word. Help me to look to you in your word. Help me not to wander around looking for answers from men here and there, or prophetic stuff, or things that can seem quick to give you answers. But let him help you wait on him. That when you say in your word, wait on me, tell him, Lord, help me to wait on you. Help me to look to you, God, in dark moments, in difficult times, in jubilation times, celebration moments. Father, help us, oh God. Sometimes we have wandered away from your word, Jesus, and there are moments that, God, we have doubted it. We pray that you forgive us, God. Times have been misinterpreted it. Forgive us, Abba Father. And we pray this morning in the name of Jesus that you will help us, Holy Spirit, to abide by the word, to stick to it, oh God, with all the proof that you have taught us this morning. We choose to believe it, God. We choose to honor your word. We choose to live by it. We choose to defend it. We choose to construct upon the foundation already laid, oh God. Thank you for the people that you used to write it. And you being the main author of it, Lord, teach us then to understand the same word. Holy Spirit, elaborate for us the scriptures that we can be able to grow, become mature believers who will be also able to share the same gospel to other people in our communities, in our families, in our nations, in the entire globe, until everyone, Lord, is caught up with the truth of the word. We thank you, Father. May the same word, Lord, just come alive in each of our lives, touching everything in our lives, for the word is sharp, sharper than any double-edged sword, God. Lord, dividing dividing the bones and marrow, the soul and the spirit, oh God, discerning the hearts of men. Father, let the power of your word, Lord, meet your children at their points of need. Let it come alive, for Lord, your word is alive to us. We thank you, Father, for we pray all this believing in the greatest name of Jesus Christ. And somebody say amen. Man, would I just invite us to stand our feet? It is giving time, and I usually say giving time is really a blessing time. And the Bible encourages us that we give generously out of what God has blessed us with, that each one of us gives as you have decided in your heart. So you will have your tithe. The ushers will be waiting on us with the envelopes. You can place your tithe in there. And any other kind of giving that you have and you want to specify, just get the envelope and write it there. And every other offering, we'll just put it on the offering bags that we'll be moving around. Please, let's rise up on our feet as the worship team bless us. Otherwise, thank you. Thank you so much.
Praise God. The song says, these are the days of Elijah. Hallelujah. Love for Jesus. Love for Jesus is mighty, is worthy, like him.